Hello, everybody. This webinar is intended as an introduction to the August workshop about converting an advantage. You can see here the banner and the lecturers. And while scrolling a bit down, you can find here the whole information. I will just mention the four themes of this workshop. Psychological mistakes to avoid when converting an advantage, converting an advantage by simplification, restricting the opponent's counterplay, and playing on both wings as a method of converting an advantage. In the today's lecture, I will touch, I will exemplify all these ideas. But before moving on, I will also mention that all the games I'm going to show are part of databases I have published on modern chess. If we go to the endgame section, we can see, okay, I have written three databases about Magnus Carlsen, but only one of them is here in the endgame section. The other three I will use are about Ulf Andersson's technique in the endgame. You can see them here. Just a minute, I access now the middle game databases. Here we have, okay, these are also mine. Okay, learn from Magnus Carlsen, and these are the themes. And now, okay, we'll move back there. I will now share the screen again, but only part of it. Okay. So here we are. I believe the board is visible. Okay, so I will take the mentioned themes one by one. I will start with two games by Carlsen, which are related to restricting the opponent's counterplay. This is his game against Howard. We see that he has sacrificed two pawns in the early phase. Okay, one of the pawns doesn't really count so much because it's a double pawn. I mean, for dynamic reasons, it's not so important. Well, maybe it's early to talk about an advantage for white. But okay, white is in control. Black is passive. He cannot think of anything active. And Carlsen started his attack in a very surprising way because he perfectly understood that he will need to lift one of his rooks, at least, for instance, rook f3, rook g3. And he didn't want to have his king vulnerable on the back rank. Okay, after rook ad8, if the queen moves away, or I don't know, the other rook, the b rook, then rook d1 would lead to simplification. So the first thing he did, I mean, okay, you want to attack, you are two pawns down. And the first thing you are doing is playing. Sorry. I just moved the board. The first thing you do is moving h3. And of course, okay, we see that there is a rook attacked on d6, but at this height, Carlsen would never think of taking on d6. I believe that if he takes on d6, he simply works because after cd, Black has two pawns for the exchange, and his pawns are advancing. So this we don't discuss in detail. The knight on e4 is actually one of White's strongest pieces, probably even stronger than the bishop on c4 at his height. Let me check. Okay, hello everybody. Yes, I see that there are a lot of hellos in the chat box. Okay, so h3, rook d8, and now king h2. And now, okay, there is a small problem with Black. He has reached some maximal development and activity. The queen doesn't have active moves along the second rank. The bishops are stuck where they are because, okay, they offer some stability. And there is also no rook intrusion. For instance, if rook d2, then... okay, under these circumstances, he would probably take the exchange, and suddenly rook b8. And now, okay, there is a big danger. There are things with, for instance, the threat is rook takes e8 and bishop takes f7. If the queen moves away, then queen h5 may create some problems. So let's go back to King h2. So we can say that black is almost in some sort of Zugzwang. Actually, okay, he could have sort of playing the c5 or something like that. But okay, Howler needed like doing something. Queen a4, rook b4. And now probably queen h3 was not the best move. Somehow the queen doesn't do much there. Maybe queen a5 to keep c7 defended. Maybe queen back to c2 also. And now, okay, white plans to go queen e3. Carlsen slightly changed his regrouping. Okay, black is still not doing much. He's a bit passive. And now, okay, rook e7 was suddenly a mistake. Okay, rook d6 was recommended. Well, first of all, if rook d1 now, then rook b4. And it's important that the king is on h2 and there is no rook f1 with check. So this is the first moment when this is quite important. Oh, sorry, my board went away. Okay. So let's go back to queen a4, rook b4 here. Okay, I have to adjust the position. Queen a5 had been recommended, but it's not really so clear. And now they say, okay, now the threat is knight except six. They recommended this, but actually this is not so simple. Now here, now he can take the exchange. Okay, f7 was hanging. And queen g4, and okay, if black had an extra tempo, I mean, if queen d1 came with check, then he would have the time to play queen e1 and e4, and suddenly black would have a very strong counterplay. His bishop would revive. But the way it is, he's not in time. Now it's simply, okay, the attack breaks through. All the black pieces are overloaded. So, sorry, we have to go here. Oh, no, sorry. Queen e2. Okay, and rook e7 was the move. And now, okay, Carlsen found the first way to get an advantage. This and queen e3. Now there is a threat of queen h6 followed by rook f3, mating. So he tried to clear some space, but okay, problems came from the other side. Rook here, queen c2, rook d8. Suddenly the rooks are hanging. Rook d7 and bishop e6 won material, because if f takes e6, f takes d6, yeah, it's bad. So he went here, but okay, Carlsen won this. So this h3, king h2 were indeed some very subtle moves. Carlsen didn't know what he was going to do when he played these moves. He just felt it's right. I mean, he has to think of a way of preparing his attack, depending on what the black is doing. But he knew quite clearly that the king has to be safe so that black doesn't have counterplay. We saw that in at least two lines, this missing tempo that there was no check was bad for black. And now, we have this other game, Carlsen with black against Rowson. There should be, let me see if I remember. Yes, I rotate the board. Okay. So once again, we cannot say that at this height, Carlsen has an advantage, but he has an active position. It's a quite active version of the hanging pawns. And okay, all his pieces are in the right places. And the only active move he can think of is knight e4. Of course, he wanted to do that, but knight e4 implies some small problems. If he goes here, then knight takes d5 works. Here, and now suddenly, there is rook takes d5 winning material. So he understood that he cannot go knight takes d5 at once. Because after knight e4, white would black would suddenly have quite an active position. So you probably guessed already, he went king h8. With the position still close to equality, okay, quite active for black, but not very clear. White should have also sort of prophylaxis. He should have understood what Carlsen wanted to with king h8. Of course, king h8, like in the Sicilian, you play king h1 with white or king c1 to b1 if you have castle long. Yes, but this automatism should not prevent you from understanding concretely what that move means in a specific position. And the best thing white could do was bishop f1, which is good for many reasons. It protects the first rank. There will be no rook takes d1 check, for instance. It also takes the bishop out of the knight's range, because after knight e4, d takes e5, there is this knight takes e3 as an intermediate move, which should be counted with. So, and not least, the bishop is going heading for g2 or h3. I mean, okay, it takes some say important black pawns under observation. Yes, for instance, if knight e4, then he can take knight takes d5, and this combination is not entirely convincing, because actually it's not convincing at all, because it just loses a piece. Instead of this bishop f1, Rosen played queen b1. Now, if we talk about these psychological mistakes when looking for activity, one of the main things is usually you should think twice before hurrying to go straight forward, because queen b1 attacks f5 and is practically inviting knight e4 in the hope that it would offer white some tactical possibilities. But actually, white was not prepared for that. Knight e4 followed. Now, knight e5 doesn't work, because in this line, there is suddenly knight c3. So it's over. We see that, the queen is badly placed on b1. That was just one detail. So he went d takes e5. Now d5 is hanging, but knight takes e3. Now we see again that, the bishop and the queen are hanging. If c takes d6, then check, queen here takes and queen here. And suddenly the pin is very unpleasant. There is a set of knight e5, but also of d4. So actually, white is in big trouble. So knight e3, rook takes e3, b takes e5. That was the game. And we see that black has achieved something here. He has induced white to take on c5. Now his position is very active. Looking a bit at white's pieces, it's not very clear what he's doing. Now a5, so far a neutral move. A4 is a thematic move. Some more regrouping moves. We'll soon get to another critical position. And now Carlsen made another of his mysterious moves. What makes Carlsen so strong? One of the things is that he has a power of anticipating the further evolution of the events. Because it seems that A4 would be normal, and it is a normal move. But he anticipated what white was trying to do. Actually, let's see if you can guess what white, because white is not very active. He still needs something to get some play. So which is the maneuver white would try to carry out. It's not a simple question, actually. Okay, the question is simple. I touched something wrongly. Okay, we are here. The point is that Carlsen, okay, we have an answer, possibly. Well, you understood quite well that the white knight on f3 is not the worst placed piece. Actually, white's even more effective idea is knight e1, knight d3, knight f4. And Carlsen anticipated this with a very... now we are getting close to the previous game, h6, knight e1. And okay, let's suppose that he would have played this. After a4, I mean, which is just a normal move. Knight here, rook c8, because okay, c5 was kind of hanging. Now knight here, takes. And now suddenly there is a threat f3. And the knight doesn't have good squares to retreat, because f5 is vulnerable, and also c5. For instance, okay, takes, queen here, and bishop h3. Yes, and now the knight doesn't have good squares after f3. Because one of the pawns would be hanging, the c5 pawn or the f5 pawn. If so, then f3 and bishop d6, and suddenly black has some problems. He's under serious pressure. Okay, f5 is hanging, also c5 feels vulnerable. So Carlsen must have understood all this when he played h6, because now he went to king h7, knight d3. Rook c8, okay, knight f4, takes. And now the point is that when white plays bishop h3, he will have g6. So this is why he needed the king on h7. So first he goes king h8 to restrict white's possibilities and to get ready to play knight e4. And then he understands that king h8 also has some drawbacks. So then, I mean, okay, this is not a waste of time. It's simply some prophylactical moves aimed at restricting white's, let's not call it counterplay. Now it's already about counterplay, because now suddenly black is very active. Now black can count on very good chances for advantage. Earlier it was, let's say, he restricts white's possibilities for initiative, and then for counterplay. Now another good move, but okay, this is simpler. He would like to go d4, but of course this was not possible because of... queen f8, over defends the rook. Yes, and now if bishop h3, this is what I was talking about, then simply g6 and nothing happens. The bishop is... And okay, there are no threats on the long diagonal. First of all, everything is defended around the black king. And secondly, d4 will close the diagonal. So he didn't waste time on this move. Queen a5, d4, okay, he sacrificed the pawn. But now, okay, he got a very active position, d3, and okay, he eventually, actually he won quite quickly, but now it's clear that, okay, the pawn is not important and he's just attacking. So these were the two examples, both from Carlsen's games. Related to the theme restricting the opponent's counterplay in equal positions and then in better positions. Now we'll move to the second theme. This is playing on two wings. So I think we should rotate the board again. Let me do, okay. No, what did I do? I did something completely wrong. Okay. Oh, the system tricks me. Okay, I'll go. Okay, now, unfortunately, because of my technical mistake, you saw the first move. Yeah, so I cannot really put the question properly. There is only one winning move here, and it may seem that the king has to go active to sustain the pawn, but actually it's not like this. If black plays only for one idea, I mean, okay, only for the pawn, then he doesn't win. Because, okay, let's take it this way. King d2, check here. And suddenly the king is too far and it's a simple draw. King d4 is the winning move. And actually, it's also interesting to see that king c4 is not winning. The king is too far. Just misses a tempo to get there, and this is a draw. So king d4. For the time being, the king just moved away from check, and it stays close to the enemy king. Rook a2. Of course, he would not wish to help the king coming even closer to the king side. Rook here, king here, rook g2. Again, playing on two wings. This means that he keeps the white king in some sort of cage. It cannot free the pawns pass too easily. Now, okay, white does what he should do. I mean, checking until the king goes somewhere. Now, unfortunately, yes, he hoped to force the king to e2 or to e1, but unfortunately now he has to lose a tempo because the pawn on h3 was hanging. So first here, but now, okay, this checks, okay, the king has to go there. And now the progress is quite slow. Rook here, that was a very, very good move because it just prepares this. Now check, if check king e3 and it would be over because rook e4 later. Now it threatens rook e4, so very, very wisely played. Because if you won, then the king would be too far. So he's forced to take the pawn here. And now, because of his ability of playing on two wings, he reaches this one theoretical position. Okay, this was a bit abstract. I agree, this was a bit abstract, not the classical meaning of playing on two wings, but don't worry. Now we have a clearer example. Now is a complex ending. I just wanted to highlight abstractly this notion of. I mean, it's sometimes good to start. I mean, if you have some abstract ideas, to start with a very basic and simple examples. This is almost like a middle game, queenless middle game. We see that. White structure is better. First of all, black has these double pawns, but also white structure is more central. He has more pawns in the center. True, he didn't play d4, but okay, the pawns, they are like a hedgehog. They control many, many squares. And now black played f5, which is actually okay, under certain circumstances, this would be the right move because it clears some diagonals for the bishop. But actually, it creates a small target. Of course, taking on h4, on g4 now is not really good. But actually, I will exemplify this. Let's say if h6, then g5, bishop here takes. We see that the attack starts on this wing. This and now knight b5, very unpleasant move. King here, check, and it just wins a pawn. Rook c8, and so we see a first moment when he plays on two wings. Actually, okay, here there was another variation. If rook c7, then he wins a pawn like this. So it's always this combination of playing on the g file and on the king side and inserting this knight b5. So g4, bishop g7. Okay, he doesn't wish to clear the h file, to open the h file. And now knight here. Of course, rook a6 doesn't look so right. After a3, the rook remains there a bit isolated. So king b8, he took rook here. Now, okay, he has to be careful. If rook g6, then there are things with knight d6 with a double attack. So bishop here. And okay, a3, he has to free himself because okay, now the threat is rook g1 and okay, rook, he has to drive the knight away, but okay, now he got something on the queen side. Now there are weaknesses on the whole board for black. Knight a3, of course, because he doesn't want to his knight to be exchanged on c3. That would be equal. Okay, he managed to consolidate somehow. And now, okay, the knight has done its job on the queen side. The knight now goes, this was so typical for Andersson. When he had the knight against the bishop, he would find such positions where he, his knight is dancing alone and the bishop is just looking and it cannot challenge the knight in any way. So now the knight comes here and of course, there are some dangers for the f pawn. He went here, rook d5. We see that it's a very nice invasion. A4 combines the threats. If B6, then okay, this is also kind of unpleasant for black. I gave a variation like this. It's clear that white has a lot of play. He allowed, B6 is a move which okay, weakens a bit everything. But after king c6, okay, that was no improvement. A5, this check now here. And okay, at this stage is already clear that white has quite a good position. And okay, Andersson won. I mean, everything is right for him. And he still maintains the communication. H6 was just an instructive mistake. He didn't notice the threat. He just loses a pawn. So somehow the wings are connected. That was, yes, but okay, rook g6 was called for, but okay, then again, there are pawns hanging everywhere. And it's also, if rook b6 and take, and this pin is decisive. So we see that this communication between the wings is just crashing. Now we'll see game by Carlsen. This has some relation with what I said about the wing, communication between the wings playing on two wings, but in a slightly more let me see. I have to flip the board. Thank you for okay, so flip, okay, thank you. Sometimes it's useful to look in the comments, to read the comments. So okay, we look at the position. Of course, we like black's position. I mean, okay, after this g4 played by the white, there are these weaknesses. There is a plan of invading with knight h7, knight g5. It seems that white has something on the other wing, some activity and so on. And Carlsen, let me switch this. Okay, this off. And Carlsen, Carlsen chose a very unexpected square for his king, for his queen. For instance, if he goes here, then queen g2. Okay, this would have transposed the game, but it would be no progress. If queen h4, the problem is that, he cannot carry out the maneuver without exchanging queens. So the first step was to go far with the queen. And it's actually more than that. Okay, knight b5. He also has some threats. Knight here. Now knight g5 is coming, so he took some measures against it. And now rook here. Now, okay, he has to watch the back rank. So okay, he cannot take on c5 because then, okay, the rook would intrude. So c4, consolidating. And now queen d8. It may seem that Carlsen has started play on the queen side. But actually, this is just a temporary incursion of the queen on that wing. She just defended, and now he wants to carry out his whole maneuver. Okay, knight g5 is also very strong, but okay, he went bishop g5. Now here, okay, the bishop, it is not okay. Now he has this, he has carried out this whole maneuver. King f1, and now suddenly queen h8. So we saw that everything what he did on the queen side was some sort of diversion. It was also, maybe we could call this more like using the space on both wings. Because okay, white has more space if we look at the position. Of course, he's weakened and so on. For black, it's important to have some communication. He can have communication only along the back rank. And he did that in a fantastic way. Just look how beautifully placed white's rook are on a4 and b4, and it doesn't really count. Black had the space he needed, and now the game was all okay. Topalov resigned. There is no, okay, f3 is hanging. And actually, the rooks are busy. He cannot play. He cannot defend, he cannot keep queen g1 as a defense and against queen h1 and defend the third rank. So actually the black rooks are also quite effective there on the A and B file. Some sort of pin, some sort of tension and so on. Okay. What is this? I had looked at it earlier. Okay, so let's flip the board. Okay, so this is Anand Carlsen, one of the games played after Carlsen already defeated him in the world title match. We can see that Carlsen has started some early play on the queen side. I see a question. Yes, there will be information. Grandmaster Grigor Grigorov will provide the whole information in the end of this webinar. Thank you for asking. So we see that he has displayed some activity, pushing the pawn to a3. It's not really so clear what this can mean, because okay, this is just a pawn. We'll see only later. Again, it's there are things that Carlsen is doing, probably he cannot know what they mean. I mean, he just feels that it can be right at a certain moment. This is I believe that this is what makes Carlsen such a formidable player today. I mean, nobody has a clue to what he's doing. I guess he doesn't have a clue either. He just hears the moves from somewhere. I don't say he's cheating. No, he gets his inspiration from somewhere. And we'll see that actually the pawn on a3 will have a decisive play, a decisive part in the final phase. Anyway, he now does okay what anybody would do. Try to start an attack on the king side. Okay, bishop e1 looks like a normal move. And now e5. Look, the bishop was kind of hanging on c3, and okay, he wants to go f3 at some point. So takes. Look here. Okay, some normal moves now. Again, we see Carlsen with this structure, pawns on f5 and d5. Okay, now d5 is very well defended. It was the game against Rosso, the second game. The pawn on f5 is a bit of a danger. Bishop here, g6, and now e4 takes, and okay, I would think that in principle, white is doing quite okay. One natural move now would be knight g4. just to reduce the tension there. But okay, this would be some sort of normal position for white too. Something like this, and it's probably drawn. But Carlsen wanted more. It seems that okay, there are big dangers there. But now somehow we can. Yes, it's a very typical for this play on two wings. White is relatively well prepared. Okay, his regrouping is not that great. I mean, with the bishop between the rooks, I wouldn't say that white has such a great position. But okay, he has some hopes. And Carlsen, yes, so I remember, okay, maybe many of you know the game. I remember I was watching the game live and I was quite impressed. Bishop b2, I mean, what does bishop b2 mean? Okay, he threatens knight e4 or queen e4, because earlier knight e4, queen takes e4. Okay, but he takes f5. This seems like it's simply destroying. But now there is this intermediate move. So now suddenly there is the threat of bishop d4 check. Okay, bishop f2 looks normal. And now g5. And now we see that actually he had something prepared on the king side. Yes, when you prepare such moves like e4, of course it seems that there is a strong impact, pawn impact, and that black is in some danger. But when there is a complex pawn tension, and especially if you connect such a pawn break with the bishop's activity on the corresponding squares, you always have to keep in mind that the opponent is not forced to recapture each time. No, there are such blockading moves. This would be a normal move even if black hadn't won a pawn on the other wing. And now, okay, black has achieved some stability on the king side, and he has a pawn which is just two moves away from promoting. So, okay, white has to. For white, it's already difficult. He has to find some concrete way of drawing or whatever, some attack, something. Now, rook e6. Okay, if bishop g2, then knight g4. This is not what he needs, because now the pawn on f5 is weak, and okay, the pawn on a2 is very strong. Also, the knight is dominating, so. Or if bishop f1, then knight d5. And then queen takes f5, and it's... just a moment, I saw a question. For some reason, Oh, no, it's the same old question. I don't think anything new. Well, somebody's asking about the Black King open. Well, the king is open, but okay, let's look a bit at White's possibilities to attack. I mean, he would need the bishops, for instance, on those diagonals, the long diagonal and the light diagonals on c4, for instance. But okay, the bishops are far from that. And such a knight on f6, I mean, if you have such a knight, either in the absence of the dark square bishops, or with those bishops on, but like these, where when there is no access of the white bishop to attack the knight, this is quite a strong. And okay, white has attacking ideas. The problem is that they are not. Quick enough, because the pawn, the a pawn is just very dangerous. Okay, the threat now would be g4, and if the bishop moves somewhere, then the pawn on f5 is in danger. So rook e6, this looks normal. Knight g4 anyway. Takes this, and actually, okay, for the truth's sake, white had a draw here. But actually, okay, let's try to play against Carlsen. Okay, there is only one move which is which is saving white. Which is that? So I see all kind of active moves, and actually this was this was what Anand tried, and actually none of them works. Let's take first rook g5, which was suggested, and then bishop f6. Simply leaves white helpless. The king is now safe, there are no checks, and a2, a1 is simply winning. Rook here in order to inhibit bishop d4. Okay, rook e6, okay. Let me find my... Okay. In the game, Anand try rook d7. Queen d7, f6, and now there was a beautiful move, okay, queen d1. It's just repelled the attack, and now the pawn is simply promoting. Okay, Anand tried something, but okay, it's obvious that the checks are over, and a2, a1 will just win. So instead of rook g5, okay, I saw, let me check some other suggestions. Okay, rook 1d6. Rook 1d6, okay, let's check. But rook 1d6, what if simply a2? Because I will go to g8 when you check me, and then cover with the bishop. And that seems quite convincing. Yes, and king g8. A2, king g8. And if rook g6, then bishop g7. And a1 will come with check, and okay. Then we reborn queen. If f6, then queen promotes, and queen takes f6, for instance. Yes, but I believe it doesn't work. Actually, the only... Okay, we can check it later. Let's first see rook e6, which was would have actually saved, but it was not so simple. Rook e6, because okay, it creates this possibility of f6. If bishop f6, then there is such another possible, and okay, this is probably drawn. Maybe it's still better for black, but okay, it's at least it's not lost. If queen f5, then there is this check. So, and finally, if rook e8, then okay, there are some lines here. Yes, okay, this was actually very difficult to see that, okay, here somehow it's a perpetual check because, okay, if this, yes, the king cannot escape. So, yeah, I mean, okay, rook e6 is the kind of move you don't understand what happens after after queen f5. It's not so simple to see. Basically, from practical point of view, black's position is close to winning, but okay, let's check now. Okay, now if rook here, well, I would have two questions actually. One of them is this: what if here? Ah, but maybe this doesn't work. Yes, because now there is queen c4. And even so, okay. this. Let's say check. But okay, now under the circumstances, he could even go away because h8 is defended. So somehow it doesn't look. And if instead of check, he goes, I don't know which rook here. Then possibly this is right, yes. Now, okay, the queen is hanging, okay, if he goes here, then, well, let's say this move, no? There is also some step, okay, let's say he takes, but it doesn't seem to be enough. Yes, I think it's okay. Queen c2, queen f5. Yes. And somehow everything seems to be under control. Okay, the king escapes very soon. Yeah, and okay, there is a set of mate on f1 and so on. So okay, I have a question. If I think that Carlsen specifically studied the king prophylaxis to h7. Well, I know that Carlsen is studying classics a lot, and of course, if you talk about classics, okay, you also have to include the modern classic Kasparov. And actually, Kasparov, in my database about Carlsen, I actually gave a famous game by Kasparov against Karpov. It was a position where Kasparov was in time trouble. And apparently Karpov was close to winning. Karpov had half an hour, Kasparov just minutes. And it seemed that Kasparov's attack would not go through. And I believe Karpov had a passed pawn and maybe also a small material advantage or something. And then Kasparov simply plays king h2. The pawn was on h3 already. So now rook d6, in the final position, rook d6, then I go king, king h5, no? And it seems to be over. I know that one of Carlsen, okay, there are two different concepts at the top level. There is Nakamura, who asked whether he knows Smysov's games. I said that he never looked at one. And there is Carlsen, who didn't hide the fact that he was studying the classics. Okay, right now they are playing the match, and apparently Nakamura is leading, I believe, after 3 days. There may be more ways leading to Rho. But anyway, if we were to believe the strongest player of the moment, I wouldn't make historic comparisons. I believe the classics deserve better than that. But obviously the strongest player of the last 15 years or something. He's studying the classics, and I don't think that he studied only that, but he knows all these things, and I believe that there is this innate talent. I mean, he knows a lot about strategy, about plans, and I think he's studying a lot, and also endings. Actually, right now, the next section will be about simplifying as a part of the technical process of winning. And why is it actually good to know endings very well? It's not only that nowadays you don't adjourn the game, you have to play the end game over the board, and usually you are tired when you reach the end game, and your time is not so much already. But I believe that studying endings can strengthen your middle game play too. Because okay, if you play the middle game, I believe that Grandmaster Grigorov, I saw a quote of him on the announcement of the workshop. And I don't remember the exact words, but it expressed what I also believe. You know, you are in the middle game. This is, a territory with so many possibilities. And It's like, okay, in the opening, you're like a ship going out of the port. And okay, you're going farther and farther, but you still see some land there, you know where you are. And then you're in the middle game, and the middle game is like the ocean, and you don't see anything. You are alone. And the endings would be the islands. The islands, you could reach one or another, or another continent, let's say. And you have to know a bit the map. You, when you play the middle game, you don't have to calculate only what happens now. My most successful pupil, Daniele Bocaturo, who made a fantastic progress during the time I worked with him. He was surprised that when we were analyzing certain positions, middle game position, I would centrally say, okay, this ending is good, this ending is bad, this ending is good, and so on. Yes, you have to have this orientation. Then you know where you could go. I mean, of course, if the opponent also calculates, you both calculate, okay, what is that? You have to have some direction. I mean, not just the concrete calculation for the actual moment. I got a question. Okay, somebody wants to mate me, actually. So let's see. Check here. Okay, let's see. I was talking. Okay, this is painful, of course. This should not be allowed to happen. Okay, no, of course, this is not good. Okay, so we have to go back somewhere. Check. No, it was rook here, yes. This. Okay, maybe here we should just go. Okay, maybe that was bad, what I said. Maybe we should just go. Yeah, why did I go queen f7? Maybe this makes more sense, no? No, this makes more sense. Because now actually we also have the threat queen takes f2. Sorry, okay, that was a beautiful line, but I have to spoil it. Okay, but if rook f6, okay. Yes, but I believe this is not so good for white. I mean, we play bishop b2, king g7, double rooks. With the pawn on h3, I think it should be lost. It's two rooks and a pawn for the queen. I think this is a... Yes. So... okay. No, actually, that was a nice. No, okay, this was the game. That was a nice try. Okay, I admit, bravo for mating me, but I don't know how was it rook here, bishop g7. Maybe even king h7 makes sense, but I believe that rook f7 is somehow convincing. Now all the diagonals are defended around the king. And okay, there is a threat of queen f1 mate, if anything. Okay, so now if I made this whole thing about simplifying, let's move on with some games of Andersson. Adolf Andersson is another thing. Okay, now he's white. We don't have to flip the board. He plays with Uliu Wenze. And okay, you look at the position and you think that, well, black is doing well. He has more control in the center. He's well developed. And okay, white, actually white has his queen between the rooks. Somehow it doesn't feel so right. So we wouldn't think that black would be really worse here. And actually, after knight a4, there are suddenly black has problems. One of the main things is that the c5 square is vital. I mean, white is playing for that square, and also the bishop on a6. Its situation is a bit double-edged. It puts pressure on c4, but okay, now of course he took. But again, what to do now? Because now knight a4 not only solved wide problems of communication between rooks, but also consolidated on c4. So what to do now? Knight c5 is a huge threat. If the knight comes there, then the bishop has to go back to c8, okay. That is already something. I mean, there is no easy way to defend that square. If knight e4, for instance, takes f3, and then the knight comes to c5, rook here, and okay, white has the center, but black has the center, but okay, it's not so comfortable for him. Now his rooks are not so well connected. G4, then g5, a very pleasant play. Okay, just an advantage for white. Or instead of knight e4, if he goes knight d7, then bishop a3 is probably the best, and there is a trick. Let's say he defends the pawn like this, and then cd. Again, we see that the bishop on a6 has this problem. It's not defended, and it allows such intermediate moves. This rook d1, and okay, it's a pawn. And actually, at some point, bishop b2 may neutralize the bishop's pair. So, okay, he took here. He probably thought sort of something like this with some activity. Actually, here, I can't believe that there is compensation for black. Knight e4 or knight g4 are threats. Yes, but again, we have this problem. Let me go back here, d takes e4. There is this intermediate move. Okay, it's the c5 square, it's the hanging bishop. And okay, of course, if bishop c8, bishop c4, it's simply bad. If bishop b5, then bc just traps the bishop, tragically. I shouldn't laugh at that. So Huan c3 took here, but okay, this was already, once again, Wolf got his ending with a good knight against a bad. The bishop is not really bad, but it doesn't do anything. It's just like a very, you know, luxury elite spectator. It's just overviews the battle, but it doesn't do anything concrete. And this is also partly because his structure is weak on the other wing. Actually, it makes some sense looking at the way Andersson won this game. Okay, for g3, king g2. Remember h3 and king h2. I mean, now of course g3 is the right move. It just puts a pawn in the bishop's way. So king g2, the king is on a light square. I mean, technical players play this just like this before anything. And now, actually a very beautiful sequence, knight e4. Knight e4 already threatens rook takes e6 and rook a5, the natural way of pairing the threat, actually the only way. Of course, if a4, then there is also weakness on b3. And then knight c5 back. A little bit puzzling, what is he doing? But okay, now he isolated the rook on that wing. Okay, there is also the threat of knight b7. And okay, now black went wrong. Rook a3 would have still offered some chances. I mean, okay, at least now the rook still attacks a2. But okay, white could regroup like this, and then rook c2. Of course, playing with a rook on a3 is not everybody's dream. I mean, rook c2 is not even necessary because it doesn't have to take on c6. King f3, e4, somehow an attack, and he'll have some material advantage on the king side. Yes, he went rook b8, and now knight a4, another knight jump. And suddenly the pawn on c6 is lost. Of course, the game continued, but okay, once white won a pawn. I mean, everything started with knight a4, changing queens, creating this problem on c5, and then he used the c5 square so intensively. Knight e4, knight c5 back, and then the knight lands back on a4, on the edge of the board. Yes, Dr. Tarash, the knight can stay well there. And it was basically over from technical point of view. Well, we didn't have examples with the psychological things you should avoid. Just a moment, somebody asked a question. It may be interesting. So knight here, takes, and knight d7 now. Knight d7. So, okay, let's see which pieces are hanging now. It's not a bad question. So knight d7, bishop b2, but okay, if we take here, he takes, it also looks like an unpleasant ending. I mean, it's the same thing with, okay, it's opposite colored bishops, but I'm not sure to which extent it can be good for, I mean, okay, it's slightly worse for black, that's sure, but maybe it's more than that, no? This is at least a slight advantage, but let me think if I can find something even better. Well, because if bishop g7, knight c5, then I don't see an advantage. Knight d3 is coming, so yeah, probably that should be takes. And okay, yes, maybe black's chances to hold are bigger than in the game, because okay, it's opposite color bishops, but still not a lot of fun. Maybe bishop here she should try, yes. Maybe we don't have to define this rook yet. Maybe it's better if bishop a3, then rook a4 maybe. Probably bishop a3 is the good move anyway, but okay, black has some fortress here. Let me look. Yeah, somehow this seems to be quite a small advantage. Why didn't he play this? It's yeah, maybe I should do that to try to trap the bishop. Yes, knight d7, knight a6, takes. Yes, but with rook b1 probably. Yes, rook b1 with the bishop here. Yeah, maybe b4 is kind of bad. Yeah? If c5, then probably b5 is kind of unpleasant, because then we get his majority. The bishop goes to f3, maybe. And if the bishop goes, let's say here, then okay, we have some free hand. Okay, then maybe knight b4. Maybe rook here. I'm not sure how we should start. Maybe rook here or knight b4. Yes. There is play for white, of course. Okay, it's a weak pawn, and again we have this bishop, which is I wanted to insert the bishop into play somehow, but yes, it's dangerous to put it on a3. So okay, anyway, I had some reserve examples left, so already overstepped 1 hour. Now I wanted, okay, I didn't select examples for psychological things you should avoid when traps, let's say, when you have an advantage. Because actually the games I took from the database are well played by our heroes, Carlsen and so they avoided such traps. I believe that it's more useful if we you ask some questions about these things, so that it can be an interactive. We have some 10-15 minutes of questions and answers. So let's discuss some of the psychological aspects when you have an advantage. What I know myself, I can start talking. When you have an advantage, it's not so important. I have learned this from Karpov. I mean, just the guys which were big when I was learning chess and becoming, learning chess, learning serious chess, not how to move. When you have an advantage, it's not important to win quickly. No, the important thing is to prevent the opponent from equalizing. So actually, it's also psychological. I mean, okay, you have an advantage. Life is beautiful. Why would you hurry to make a bluff hoping to win quickly? Okay, what are you doing after that? Because okay, you are there to play chess. Of course, if you see a forced win, you take it. You don't risk. You have an advantage. The opponent is not going anywhere. He's, you know, under your squeeze. Okay, this is a beautiful day for you. You should just proceed. Don't take it as a big burden that you have to win the position. No, you keep the advantage and you look for an opportunity to convert it. The second thing, when I had some of my best shapes, a friend told me that he noticed that when I got an advantage, a big advantage, let's say almost winning, but okay, still to work on it. What he noticed was that I became very focused and I tried to make the very best move. So I think this is, I'm not necessarily giving myself as an example, but I believe all the guys, I mean, Fischer, if you look at him, Kasparov, he was not an endgame expert, for instance, but when he got a big advantage in the endgame, endgame was not his best, let's say. Okay. All the world champions had some level of endgame knowledge, but when you say Kasparov, you don't necessarily say endgame. I noticed that in many cases, he won the straightest way. Yes, when the position is winning, you have to be very responsible. It's okay when the position is not clear, okay. What will be, you do something. But when you have the win there, you cannot afford to spoil it. I mean, it can be bad for many reasons. Okay, for the classification, for your optimism, I mean, okay, that's serious already. I know somebody says that he tends to be more sloppy when, you have to understand that, you have worked hard to reach that advantage. And a decisive advantage is, there are also so many football games, they are playing, they are just moving the ball from there to there and nothing happens. There is the magical moment of the goal, okay, or decisive attack. That's something which you don't find. I mean, okay, you cannot say, okay, I got the decisive advantage. If I spoil it, then I will build it again. No. This doesn't happen. It doesn't go this way. No. The opponent also has a right to exist. Once you caught him, you have to understand that you shouldn't fear that you lose the advantage. You should just stay focused and try to take it very seriously. Not to go and give interviews, look how willing I am and whatever, to tell you to your friends. No, you have to sit there alone with your thoughts. Even if you walk while he's thinking, but you have to have this thing that, yes, I have to take the point home. The worst is to convert an advantage when there are spectators to the game. Okay. Yes, I know the feeling. You want to impress them. It's a good question. yes, I I can understand the feeling. But maybe you can deviate a bit your feeling. I mean, if they are watching, for them it's also important. I mean, unless they are your enemies. I mean, okay, if they are your friends, that's clear. If they are just neutral spectators, I believe that the spectators want to see the winning player, how he wins. So you should feel also that, okay, there is responsibility. Okay, I have the guys, but now I stay with the game, and then we talk about how beautifully I won. Sometimes when I have a small advantage and faced with some forcing and unbalancing moves played fast by my opponent, I have more risk to make mistakes or get into time trouble. Yeah, well, basically, when you have a decisive advantage, it's a good thing to have some time. I mean, this already develops the discussion. I mean, you have to distribute your time harmoniously. I mean, if you get a winning position and then you are with your flag hanging, okay, there are no more flags hanging nowadays. There is this increment thing. The only advice I could give is that, okay, if the opponent moves quickly something, don't necessarily believe him. I mean, he probably did that because he's scared to death. I mean, he knows he's losing, and he just, it's a desperate thing. If the position is winning, okay. Of course, this is very relative, because during the game, you could think you are winning, and it could be that you are not. But let's say if objectively you have all the reasons to know that you are winning, and if the opponent bluffs a bit, then of course you have to, you have to. Sometimes there is a simple way to answer to such a dynamic or whatever crazy move. But sometimes, in order to maintain your advantage intact, you have to go his way and calculate. So. Yes, it's the winning process is not so simple. I mean, you just put on the automatic pilot and you have to understand how to play technically or attacking mode, combinative, whatever. You have to feel. This is why you have to stay focused, and why the responsibility is very big about it. There are more questions. Well, how to deal with an advantage with time pressure? Well, I believe this was the Grandmaster Kotov, classical Soviet Grandmaster, also known author, who said that getting into time trouble is almost as bad as blundering a piece. So this was what actually I partly answered this, not only partly, this question without seeing it. I mean, you have to think of it in advance. I mean, okay, if you get into time trouble, then of course you have to do what you can. I mean, okay, at least you have a big advantage. You see how you deal with the situation. It's not a perfect situation if you have little time, but well, this getting flagged, okay, this may refer, I don't know if it refers to online blitz. Okay, online blitz is another thing. I'm basically talking about over the board classical rhythm of play. In blitz, of course, okay, I also play a lot of blitz here on Liches, and I get flagged sometimes. Okay, what can I do? Especially when I play without increment. Generally speaking, in time travel, I mean, the human body is clever somehow. When you are in on the edge, let's say, with the time, because okay, a danger in a real life, I believe, it has no weaker impact on the human mind and body and everything than time travel in chess, because chess is so real. I mean, when we play chess, this is life. During the game, this is real. At least this is how I feel many times. So your body will also help you. You will see in that half a minute, which is the increment, as much as you would normally see in 5 minutes. I had such experiences. So, but you should also admit that, okay, this is it. I will do my best. And if you lose part of the advantage or have some surprise, okay, what can I do? You have to optimize the cards you have. Not the optimal card. No, but you should have time and advantage. And then it should be fine. But if you don't have time, okay, it's part of the game. Because, okay, you invested something into something else. And now you don't have so much of what you have invested, meaning time. You have the advantage. So, okay, there is some justice. You can trade a bit back, just to reach the control, and then. So let me see if.
Thank you, Mihail, for the wonderful lecture.
And thank you.
Hello from me to everyone. I think that those were the questions. I don't know.
I think I took them all.
Yeah.
I believe.
Thank you for the honest answers.
Well, chess is about being honest. I mean, yeah. It's not like poker. I mean, we both see the same reality, so no tricks.
Okay, and guys, I just want to remind you that we were having a workshop on the same subject next week. I can paste a link right now if you want to see more details, or if you have any questions about the workshop, you can ask them now. And also, as after any other webinar, we are giving a promo code for all our products. So the promo code, Grigor probably will announce it. What is the promo code for this webinar?
I have written the promo code in the chat. This is webinar 1608, and I should add that the promo code is valid for all the products with the exception of the workshop.
Yeah, this is like
yes, webinar 1608. Yeah, this is the promo code. This code gives you 30% discount. Yeah, if you have any questions concerning the workshop or the website, we are available to answer.
In the meanwhile, I saw some pleasing comments in the chat, so thank you those who appreciate me. It's always pleasant to hear.
Okay.
So,
yeah, there are not so many questions. We can finish.
If I don't possibly see on live all the webinar in the workshop, no problem. Even if you cannot attend the lectures, you will have recordings and PGN files from the webinar, from the workshop. Sorry.
Yeah, for all the lectures, you have recordings and PGM files with comments, and you get a promo code for 25, a voucher for 25 euros for products in the website.
And for those of you who are already registered for the workshop, I want to make an announcement. You will find 4 training positions which will help you to prepare for the workshop. You can find the positions in my resources section. Okay, thank you for your kind words.
Yeah. Okay, then thanks everyone, and yes, see you next week. See you.
It was a pleasure for us to be with you.
Yeah, thank you, Mihail, once again.
Thank you. Good luck to everybody.
Yeah. Bye-bye, guys.
Bye-bye.
see you soon. We're hoping to organize more and more events like that. So hold that.
Stay tuned.
Bye. You Ciao, can also, oh, I forgot to mention just one thing, that you can also check our YouTube channel. If you miss part of the lecture or you want to check the some of our older webinars, you can just type Modern Chess in YouTube and you are finding, you will find our YouTube channel.
Yeah, today's webinar will be available tomorrow, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much.
Bye, guys.
Have a good evening. Bye. Bye-bye.